Kindly wait for a few minutes.
Hello.
Sir, some technical.
No problem.
What is for joining, sir, again?
Yes. No problem. Can you see my slide?
Sir?
Can you see my slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
The participants are joining, sir. Kindly wait for a minute, please.
So now if I do some, this full screen mode, can you see also?
Yes, sir.
And if I change, you can also listen, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay. So Miss, I would be using this, changing this, so I cannot see the other screen. Okay.
Okay, sir.
If there is a question, they can unmute themselves and then ask me question. So sir, what is the time frame given to me? How much time I have?
1 hour, sir.
Okay, fine. So I think I will talk about 45 minutes or something, and then we will have a break, 15 minutes question answer kind of thing. Okay.
Sure, sir.
You please remind me of time.
Sure, sir. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Let me know when I have to start.
Yes, sir, I will tell you, sir. 1 minute, sir, please. 106 participants join. Actually, 240 plus participants there. We will start within 2 to 3 minutes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. So we can start the session, sir. The participants can join.
Okay. So. Okay, sir. Am I audible to participant? Can you
yes.
Anybody?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
Fine. Okay. So again, I will begin with the starting. So we will talk about the visual object tracking. So object tracking is a very important problem. I will talk about applications a little later. Although I have a lot of slides, so I will try to rush up a couple of concepts, but we will try to address the basic idea, what is the tracking and then what are the different issues. These are the contents of my talk. Okay. So to understand what is visual object tracking, we have a sequence of images. Let's say a video is there. We can consider a video as the collection of n such image sequence. Okay. And then in first frame, we have the bounding box for target. Okay. So this is the target bounding box. And then we need to track this bounding box in subsequent frames. Okay. So this object is moving. Okay. It might be changing its shape. It might occlude it. So there are many possible variation that might happen to the object. And then, but you, the objective is to track the persons or the bounding, the target in the subsequent frame with a very high accuracy. Okay. That is what we actually intended to do in a visual object tracking. Okay. So what is our objective? To estimate the target state vector over time, track the target. What are the state? State means position, appearance, velocity, and so on and so forth. Okay. What is the shape and other thing also could be considered. Okay. So this is a very simple, you know, sequence. Let's say here you see a butterfly. Okay. This butterfly is actually, you know, changing its shape, and then it is taking multiple, you know, locations, and we want to track. Okay. We want to track in every possible frame where this, you know, butterfly would be there. And remember, this butterfly would change its shape. So I'm showing this our work, one of our work, where we don't only encircle the object in a square bounding box or rectangle bounding box, but we change the rotate the bounding box as per the rotation in the object. So that is rotation adaptive object tracking. Okay. And then the objective is to really know in every frame where is the object. And then once you know in every frame, you can actually create a, you know, tracklets or trajectories of the target. So that is another basic idea. Okay. So what is the real world application with the tracking? We can do motion analysis. So let's say anomaly detection in traffic. Okay. So suppose you want to detect whether how the traffic is, you know, moving in a particular you know, junction, you can actually use the this tracking multiple objects, and then you would have an idea how each object is tracking in a given scene. Okay. Similarly, we can use this for surveillance. So suppose you want to count how many people are there, where they are moving. So again, this can be useful. Okay. And then you locate, suppose some object is there, you can continuously track as long as it is available in the field of view. Then autonomous robot and car, they also use a couple of object tracking concept. Image guided surgery is another application. We want to track the continuous tracking of the particular drug, or you want to basically do a surgery kind of a thing. So how you will position the object so that it can reach into right place. That is also another very important aspect. Biomedical image analysis also one such area where people use to track the cell movement and the tissue, with how this RBC and WBC are traveling inside a region. Okay. And then human computer interaction, when I talk about virtual reality, augmented reality, people do use this tracking of the hands, and then you use that tracking of the gesture, and then you use that knowledge of tracking to change the scene and other things. Okay. But there are a lot of challenges involved in tracking. Okay. So tracking is basically the deformation can happen. Okay. So this is, in this particular frame, you are seeing that you have a basketball stadium where we want to track a particular object. What it can happen, it can change. Okay. It is no longer the same shape in the next subsequent frame. So this is a deformation problem. Illumination variation. So now in this particular image, it is, you know, yellowish, but in this particular image, it is more saturated image. So illumination can also change because of the changing in the condition, environmental condition, or the, you know, problem with the sensor. That is another problem. How do you really track the object still when illumination changes are there? Blur and fast motion. So whenever object move, so most of you must be aware of that, whenever some object moves, and we are recording the average information of the sensor, the object. So this blurring kind of a, you know, thing would be appearing in the sensor. So this is blur and fast motion also is a problem in tracking. So we don't know what object we are seeing. Okay? Then background clutter is another very important problem, how object can be tracked even if the background appears to be identical to the object itself. So, okay? So all these challenges are very important. Then out of plane motion, so let's say in this particular frame, you see that object is looking frontal, but then in other frame, it is looking leftwards, and then it is rotation. Okay, so this is out of plane rotation and in plane rotation. So both is possible in a real world scenario. Occlusion is another problem. So where people occlude themselves with some object or some hand or something, still you want to track. Okay, you may not have a full view of the particular object in subsequent frame. That is also a problem. Scale is another problem. So when you take a, let's say, static surveillance camera, the object, when it is far, it is smaller in scale. As and when it comes to the near to the camera, the scale of the object changes. So all this are the very important challenges. How do you basically design or come up with a robust visual object tracking algorithm which tracks better under all the challenging problems? This is the actual research problem. People are working on developing multiple algorithms, and it is kind of a difficult so far that not a single tracker can overcome all possible problems. So still it is an open area, and then a lot of research is going on in this particular area. Okay. So the question is, how do you represent an object? Okay, so this is kind of a very important. So the challenges are, how do you basically come up with a significant appearance variation over time? How do you encounter this variation of the appearance into the particular frame? That how do you really consider that thing, and then you can design a tracker? Okay, so what is our goal? We want to find a representation that is descriptive enough to disambiguate target versus background. So the object representation means how do you represent the object? Okay, such that it has a discriminative feature, as well as we can say that it is not the background. Okay, that is first thing. And it is flexible enough to cope up with scale, pose, illumination, and occlusion. Okay? And objects can be represented by their shape and appearance. So there are methods for shape representation, like point is one such idea. So we represent it by the centroid or the set of point suitable for tracking objects that occupy the small region. Okay, and then we also use some primitive or geometric shapes, let's say rectangle, ellipse, object motion for such representation, usually modeled by translation or affine or projective transformation. Okay, sometimes we also use silhouette and contour for representing the object. So contour is the boundary of an object, silhouette is the region inside the contour, and silhouette and contour representation are suitable for tracking complex non-rigid shapes. This is some example. How do we track? So this is the person. We take a couple of points around the object, or we enclose the person inside a bounding box or different shapes, and then we track. Okay. Otherwise, you can do using contour, or you basically find out the silhouette for the objects. Okay. And then, so we talk about the appearance and representation. So templates formed using simple geometric shapes or silhouette. Self-adaptation for templates during the tracking is possible. And we also can define using the probability densities. It could be either a parametric or Gaussian mixture of densities or non-parametric using Poisson window. So you can either use this template. A template is just a region around in a patch in a particular frame, or it could be a probability density that we want to match over a subsequent frame. So that is what the idea is. Okay. So how do we select proper feature? Okay. So from light to useful information. So basically, generally we have such a frame, means we generally get an image as an input to any tracker. The idea is to find out the right possible representation. Okay, how do you really do a feature selection? So some people do what, they take a patch and then plot the histogram. That could be one feature. Okay, histogram could be one feature. And then you start matching the histogram. So some otherwise what we can do use the color feature. Okay, so what we can do, we can take the RGB, LUV or HSV. These are the different color spaces. We can convert from one color space to another color space, okay, but the problem is it is influenced by the spectral power of distribution or the illumination and surface reflectance. Some people suggest you use the edge feature, okay, identify the strong chances in the intensities, okay, and it is less sensitive to the illumination changes compared to the color feature. So we know that if you use color feature, then it might be affected by the illumination, but if you use the edge feature, they may not be affected by the intensity variation. Other people also suggest that we can even use the texture feature. Why only use edges and color? You can use the texture. So texture means the little surface details of the object. Okay, so it measures the intensity variation on the surface, and it quantifies properties such as smoothness, regularity. That could be also used as a tracking feature. Okay, and then people also do use this optical flow. Optical flow, if you are not aware of optical flow, so basically it is nothing but the computing the motion vectors in a two-dimensional space, local or global motion in the two-dimensional space, and finding the how much object would be moving in a particular scene. So that is one such idea. It is there, okay, and it can be computed using brightness constraint. Okay, there are some very popular method like Horn and Schunk, and different methods are there which can be used to compute the optical flow. Then also people use the gradient feature. Gradient points in the direction of most rapid increase in the intensity. So we can use this HAAR kind of a filter, and then also compute the gradient feature, and then that could be also used as a feature into while we track the object. Okay. Nowadays trend is to use the CNN features. Okay, so convolutional neural network feature. So what we can give, we can give a frame, a single frame as an input to a CNN. And then we learn the classifier. So there are a lot of classifiers, CNN classifier. And over learning this classifier, basically what we do, we actually develop a feature space. So the CNN actually do generate features in terms of the kernels. Okay, and then we use this CNN feature, and that can be also used instead of color feature or RGB feature or something. Okay. So now people actually use this CNN for generating the features. So just to talk about a little bit of convolutional neural network. Okay, so what is a neural network? It is simple. We know that neural network is something, a function approximator. So we typically compute a function. So this is a linear perceptron which multiplies the input with a set of weights and then generate approximate the function. It is single layer neural network with a linear output units, and that can be solved linearly separable classification type. Okay. We can have a multi-layer neural network. So what we can do, we can take the, let's say W1. So this is a two-layer architecture. So W1 is the, weight, set of weight which maps X to H. This is the hidden layer, which basically are the latent representation of the X. Okay. And then we use the non-linearity. Okay, maximum of 0, W1 dot X would be a nonlinear operation. So, and then we, whatever output we get out of this nonlinear operation, we multiply with W2, and then we compute the final score. Okay, that is the another way of looking the multilayer neural network. We can actually use multiple such layer. This is the vectorized input. So this is vectorized in a sense means we are converting image into a vector and then multiplying with the weights. So this is the multi-layer neural network, and then we use the backpropagation learning algorithm to update the parameter. And deep learning means using neural network with several layers of the nodes between the input and output. And it basically, the notion here is the neural network learns the complex features. Okay. So this CNN is developed by the Yann LeCun in 1990, and it implicitly extracts relevant feature trained with the version of backpropagation algorithm. So this is a simple neural network. So we give an input, we generate some pre-processing, we do some pre-processing for feature extraction, and then we basically do a classification. This is the typical conventional way of doing a classification. But CNN, what it does, we give an input, we while training and generating output, we in turn learn the features also. Okay, so we don't have a separate feature extraction block in the convolution neural network. So we replace the complete end-to-end trainable framework. Okay, so now the CNN allows us to do a classification or regression task from an end-to-end training framework. So that is the advantage of being using CNN. This is one simple CNN architecture. So this is the image, and then we have feature maps. You see this small box, which is the convolutional filter. When we convolve this image with a filter, I will get a response value. And if you roll over this filter over an entire image, you get the feature map. Okay, and then if you use multiple such filter, you will have multiple such feature map. And then we also use the subsampling to downsample the image just to reduce the total number of trainable parameters. Okay, and also achieve these spatial invariance, okay, spatial transformation invariance. And this is a typical architecture, multiple convolution layer, multiple subsampling layer, and then finally fully connected layer. And we design a neural network to train such a model. Okay. So the neural network, CNN neural network, consists of three important aspects. We have a convolutional layer, which is generally called as a feature extraction layer, pooling or subsampling layer, which is creating the shift and distorted invariance in the feature, and the finally fully connected layer, which is for classification. Okay. So I will not discuss too much detail into the CNN. I will assume that most of you know CNN. But what we do actually here, what is the convolution is nothing but the dot product. This is the convolution filter, and this is the image patch. So you just place this patch around a particular location in the image, and you vectorize the input and then take the dot product plus the bias. Okay, that is the single input, single output you will get. And you move this convolutional filter over entire image, you will get some response map. This is the basic idea. So basically you roll over this particular filter and you get the 28x28 response map. Okay, the filter size is 5x5x3 and image is of 32x30x3. Okay. So that is the activation map. And then if you use different filter, you will have a different activation map. This is the different activation map when you use the different filters. Okay. So this is the new set of response we get from the single image. Pooling layer, what it does, it actually just downsamples the image. So you take this 224x224x64, let's say for example, and when you pool this, let's say 2x2 max pooling, it will divide the whole thing into half. So only the XY location would be turned to be half. Number of activation map would be still remain 64. Okay, so there is no compression in the wider width dimension. This is the downsampling operation. There are many such downsampling operation, max pooling, mean pooling or average pooling, so many things we can do. And then finally we have fully connected layer. So the last layer, when we get this all the feature map, what we do, we vectorize each image and assemble these this vectorized output into one over the other, and then we create this kind of stacking operation we do. So we take this green frame, vectorize it, and then take the yellow frame, append this yellow frame vector to the green frame last, and then so subsequently. So finally, we have a one single vector fully connected layer, and then we learn the output. This is the basic idea of neural network. There are multiple architecture, like LENET is there, LXNET is there, ZFNET is there, now ResNet, so many nets are there. Okay, so these are the neural network, which is actually trained for ImageNet classification, but nevertheless we can always use in our tracking also. Okay. These are the different neural network, or the deep neural network, or deep convolutional neural network, which is available for anybody to use. So if you see that thing, this neural network has outperformed significantly the ImageNet classification challenge, and now we have an accuracy which is much better than the even human accuracies. Okay. So basically, what are the use of convolutional neural network? You can use in classification, information retrieval, in detection, object detection, segmentation. Okay. We can use for self-driving cars. We can use in biomedical application, pose estimation. Okay. We can actually even use for caption generation. So you give an image and it can generate the caption for you. This is some example of caption generation. How do we use in visual object detection? That is what we're going to discuss here. So here what you see is, we can even use this CNN feature in even visual object tracking as well. Okay. So what is basically the idea? Visual object tracking started long, it's a very historical work. People always want to track the object, earlier in the term of a radar. Okay, so radar means we have let's say enemy aircraft or something is there. We want to first measure its location and then keep on tracking that particular object as long as it is available in the field of view. Okay, so what is the idea? So people earlier used to use this Kalman filter. Okay, so Kalman filter is basically nothing but you have the prior knowledge of the state, you apply some prediction step, you update the step, okay, by using the measurement whatever you have, and use this measurement and the prediction step state to update the step, and then what is the update step is there that can be used to estimate the output of the state. Okay, and then you do keep on doing this thing, and then you keep on tracking the object. This is the earlier way of doing, Bayesian way of doing the tracking of the object. So people used to do by tracking by detection by template matching. Okay, this is the very famous work by Lucase Canade and Tomasi in 1991. So what you do, you take the single frame and then you look for the object, let's say corners here, and you match the corners, and then you establish the correspondence between the each corner, and if it is above certain threshold, you basically detail that if in next frame the object is there. Okay, that is basically very computationally intensive and very not so good, but this is the earlier approaches people used. Okay, this is called the tracking by detection or by template matching. Okay, later actually this discriminative classification where so much are popular, so it can actually segment, okay, where is the object is there or not. Okay, so that is basically what we do. So we take a frame, okay, and we define the search region, okay, and within the search region we learn several classifiers, and we move this patch in the search region, because the idea is from one frame to next frame the object would not differently. Okay, that is the basic idea. And then once you search, and wherever you get the maximum similarity, you deem that to be a object is located there. Okay. Later actually this correlation filter based tracker, which is actually nowadays very popular. Okay, so 2015, this Hendricks people have proposed this correlation filter based tracker. So what is this? Basically, it's a very simple idea of correlating two signals. Okay, so the idea is if in subsequent frame object lies in the within search region, the correlation response for the object would be much higher. Okay, that is the basic notion. Okay, and then subsequently the tracking data set have been released by VOT community. So what they have done, they have benchmarked this data set, they have taken multiple different challenging videos, they have done the ground truthing of this video, and then made it available for the community to test their tracker, how good they can track the object in a given scene. Okay, so this is kind of a bench. Suppose you develop some tracker, you can actually benchmark your tracker in this VOT data set. Okay, so now every paper who work on visual object tracking, they actually qualifies their tracker on this VOT, so that they would know how good their tracker with the existing tracker. Okay, and now on 2016 actually this NAM and HAN actually developed this MDNet, multi-domain neural network based this tracking. So they first to use this deep learning architecture for tracking the in tracking. Okay, so if you see the history, we started with radar, then correlation. These are the kind of a very important discoveries. So from radar to Kalman filter, Kalman filter to correlation filter, or detection, tracking by detection, tracking by detection by discriminative modeling, and then correlation filter, then tracking data sets is challenges available, and then now basically we are using mostly deep learning based features to track the object. So what are the requirements for building a robust tracking system? First of all, it has to be robust. What do we mean by robustness here? It should follow the interest object even under the complicated condition. So the object should not be lost in a from a scene even if it is a complicated situation. Okay, that is the basic idea. That is called the robustness. So we should not lose the object in the any frame. Okay, that is the basic notion. And it should be adaptive. Adaptive means it has to be a steady adaptation mechanism for changes in the object appearance. So object would change its shape, it will be occluding, and so many deformation would happen. So the a good or optimal tracker should be able to even adapt for these changes and still doesn't lose the sight of the object. Okay? And real-time processing means it has to be a real-time system. It has to be fast. We should be able to do, let's say, 300 to 400 frames per second. That should be something. And we should be able to do, we should be able to deploy in the real working scenarios. Okay? And optimized implementation to deal with the live video streams. Suppose you want to track something in a live video feed, we should be able to do this thing. It should not be computationally too intensive that we cannot really track a particular object. Okay? So there are two distinction for the tracking algorithm. One is basically based on the appearance model. There are two such approaches. One is called generative method, other is called discriminative method. So what is generative method? It actually uses the information of the object alone. So what we do, we just model the object using some probability distribution or something, and we keep on looking that information in the subsequent frame. Okay? And then we develop a learning model that can be used to represent the target object. Okay? That is the generative model. And discriminative model, what it does, it uses the information of the object along with the background and model the background as a negative samples and treat the target as the positive samples. Okay? And then we learn a classifier that distinguishes between the target and the background. So both of the methods are preferred, but nowadays the discriminative methods are much more popular because of the development in the scene. But either way, both our methods are have their own advantages and disadvantages. Okay, so this is a typical tracking framework. Okay, so what we learn, we incrementally learn the classifier to separate targets from the background, kind of a online learning to adapt the appearance changes. Okay, there are many trackers. So let's say this is the frame T. Okay. And this is the positive sample, and around all the actual positive sample, we can take the negative sample. Okay, so and then we learn a classifier which would classify given a frame into a, whether it's a positive frame or it's a negative frame, and then basically it would adapt for the appearance model. Okay, changes in the appearance model. Okay, so what we do, we update the appearance model from the positive and negative sample, and then we learn the classifier. Okay, in step two, what we do, we update the appearance model inside of the window around the old location. So we take a old location, and when we update the appearance model, and now what we do, once we updated this new location, we now change we found the what is the difference in the actual location and the previous location, and we move the bounding box, previous bounding box, to the new location in the T plus one frame, so that we can know that where is the object now. So this is the very simple idea people use to track multiple objects using the to basically adapt for the appearance changes. Okay, so the very famous algorithm for tracking is called correlation filter for tracking. Okay, so what is our objective? We take this, let's say, frame. Okay, we learn a filter W. Okay, what is filter W? The filter W is learned in a manner that whenever it has to be correlated with the scene in the region, and if it is similar, if it is a positive sample, it will give a very high response, otherwise it will be giving very low response. Okay, so what we can show, so if you see this particular figure here, what we are showing, we are doing a correlation with the filter W, and then we are searching in a region. So wherever is the object is present, we will have a very high value, that's a green dot here, and there are some lower values around that region, but they are not so low. And then as and when the filter goes away from the actual target region, the response would be very low. Okay, so that is the basically idea. So we learn a correlation filter W, which should have a high peak at the target location and low everywhere else. Okay, that is the basic idea of a correlation filter based tracking. So there is a Moose tracker, Moose tracker. Minimum output sum is squared error filter, which is actually derived on this particular principle. So this is the first real-time correlation filter based tracking trained on the grayscale images in a Fourier domain. Why we do in a Fourier domain? Because the operations become very fast. Okay, that is the basic idea. Okay, the updates to this particular tracker is the KCF tracker. KCF is the improved version of the Moose tracker. This is called the kernelized correlation filter. So what is the contribution of this particular paper is that they actually found out that all this correlation operation, when we do in a transform domain, we can actually use the kernel filter concept, and then we can use this kernel trick idea, and that would give the very good speed up in the tracking. Okay, so they introduced the HOG feature. Okay, most of you must be knowing the HOG feature is called histogram of oriented gradients as a input feature, and then they generate the kernels for the correlation filtering. The biggest limitation of this KCF is the scale invariant. So whenever scale is changing, this tracker used to fail, it used to fail, and it is also not able to work for a long term tracking. What is long term tracking means, if I initialize a object in a first frame, it should be able to keep on tracking on a longer duration. Okay. So then basically, this is the discriminative correlation filter. So what we use is basically you generate different feature map, single resolution feature map, and then you generate this correlation filter, and then once you convolve this or correlate this filter with the different resolution. So what is the resolution means, you take an image and you do scale space pyramid. Okay, take a scale space pyramid and then correlate with the filters. Okay, and then it can actually adapt to the scale variation. Okay, so and then whichever scale gives the highest response, that is the object location you can think of. Okay, this is the basic idea of a discriminative correlation filter, and here mostly it is assumed that the response of the filter would be a Gaussian kind of a nature. Okay, so what is the idea here? It utilizes the periodic assumption of the training sample to efficiently learn a classifier on all patches in the target neighborhood. It also enables efficient training and detection in the fast Fourier transform domain, and it aims to learn a multi-channel convolution filter F from a set of training example XK and YK. So we have a training set example which is used to learn a filter. Okay, and once this filter is learned, okay, this XK consists of d-dimensional feature map that extracted from an image region, and desired output YK is the scalar valued function, includes a label for each location in the sample. And we do what? We convolutions response of the filter F on an n cross n sample of X can be computed using simply correlating this feature with the filter L for all d-dimensional features. This is the score, which is the response of the all possible d-dimensional feature with the filter coefficients F of L. Okay. And then we learn this filter by representing in a loss function formulation. This is the energy function or objective function representation. So what the idea is to minimize this E of F. Okay, so S of F is the score which is computed. So if you see the previous equation, S of F is the score of the filter F of L onto the image feature generated by the different image locations. Okay, and this is the ground truth target location. So we want to minimize this error. We want to minimize this error over all possible T frame. T frames are used for training this correlation filter. And we find out the what filter coefficient. Okay, we are trying to learn the filter coefficient F such that I get the minimum possible error. Okay, and we also do regularization of the filter coefficient. This is the F. F is the regularized value of F. So we don't want the weight should be taking unbounded value. Just to keep a bound on the filter coefficient, we also do a regularization. This is the smooth regularization, and we are combining this with a Lagrangian parameter lambda. Okay. So this can be actually transformed into a Fourier domain where the resulting normal equation have a block diagonal structure. So if you take into Fourier domain, it would be very simple, simple matrix multiplication. And the location of the target in a new frame T is estimated by applying the filter that has updated them in the previous frame. Okay. Later, what people have done, actually, they also improved the correlation filter by spatially regularizing the discriminant correlation filter. So what they do, they use the spatial regularized component in the DCF formulation. This is also a very famous paper. Introduce a spatial weight function used to penalize the magnitude of the filter coefficient in the learning. It also used the regularization of weights W, determining the importance of the filter coefficient FL depending on the spatial location. Okay? And coefficients in filter FL residing outside the target region are suppressed by assigning a higher weight in the W and vice versa. So this is the very simple idea. So the same EFF, we have introduced a W. W is the, you know, such a looking filter. So we penalize the filter coefficient if the responses of this filter coefficient outside the region is very high. We penalize very much, okay? And then when it is within the bound, we don't penalize. So it's going to be inverted penalization by a W factor. W is the factor we multiply with the filter coefficient. So whenever we are doing a wrong assessment, okay, we should penalize it more so that the when we optimize this loss function, it should be able to find the right possible filter coefficient. Okay. Yeah, it will take some time to understand this equation, but I think overall idea should be clear. We are minimizing this equation, okay, we are learning the filter coefficient such that we can get the better response. But whenever the responses are wrong from some filter coefficient, we are penalizing it by multiplying with a W weight factor. Okay, so this is the correlation filter based tracking approaches. Now people are actually using the CNN based approaches in object tracking. So what is the idea here is, now we want to exploit the expressive representation of the convolutional neural network, either using CNN as a generic feature extractor for tracker or directly training a CNN tracker. Okay, so either way we can do, you can use the CNN for only feature extractor, or you can design a CNN which can do tracking from end to end. Okay, both are possible. We want to exploit the pre-trained CNN feature on massive data and classification task on ImageNet. So I told you in the beginning that there are multiple CNN track ImageNet trackers are there. It's not ImageNet, convolutional neural networks are there. So what we can do, we can use those pre-trained model to generate the feature from a image and then use as a feature to the our tracker. Or we can do what? We can do the use the lower convolution layer carries more discriminative feature information, and that can better separate the target from the distract from the similar appearance. So what is the idea? So we understand that when we do an object classification task, the CNN must be learning the where is the object and where is not the object. So when we use the lower layers, we might have a better discriminative information, and that can be used. Okay, and the top convolution layer imports more semantic features. So now, so in a deep learning framework, what is the idea is, it's a multi-layer architecture, and if we use couple of lower layer, couple of upper layer information, we might have a better semantic information or better edge feature. So either way, we can actually combine this very easily. And then if you apply this, both layers are jointly used, and then with a switch mechanism, it can be used for tracking. So this is typical CNN architecture. So if you see this particular frame here, you see that these are the lower layer, you know, features. Let's say convolution third layer, and this is the fourth convolution layer and fifth convolution layer. So in a different layer, we have a different feature response. So in some layer, we have a very prominent response from the object. In some layer, we have very good tracker, means edge related information. So we use this feature level information, and that can be used to track in a tracker. So this is the feature visualization from using a simple VGGNet. Okay, VGGNet is the visual geometry group from Oxford University. They have developed this neural network. You can directly use this pre-trained model and then combine the different weights layer and then generate a feature for your tracker. So different layers encode different type of feature. Higher layer capture the semantic concept on the object categories, whereas the lower layer encodes the more discriminative features to capture the intra-class variation. So that can be used to see. So this is the simple frame here. You can see that thing. This is the response of a heat map. Okay, so this is the ground truth target heat map. This is the ground truth target heat map. And this is the predicted heat map using feature maps of the top convolution layer of the VGG. And C is the predicted heat map using the feature map of the lower convolution layer of the VGG. Okay, so you can see that thing where high layer and lower layer computes different kind of information. So So now what, how do we use this idea into tracking? Okay, so what we do is basically we take a current frame, okay, generate, we define a search region within the previous location in the subsequent frame, okay, and we extract the various patches from the search region, and these patches has been given to, you know, after normalization, we give to a neural network, okay, neural network, then it generates the different feature map, and then we classify whether it's a true label or whether it's a, you know, false label. So that is the feature we generate. Okay, so we give this patch and extract the feature from this layer. Okay? So there are multiple CNN based object tracking methods are there. GoTurn is the generic object tracking using regression network is there, which can, you know, track up to the speed of 100 frames per second. There's MDNet is the very famous tracking multi-domain convolutional neural network tracker, which is offline training in capturing the target repeated into the shared layers of the CNN, while the online tracking estimating the target. Deep SRDCF, we have seen, it is the variation of the SRDCF. We give the deep learning feature instead of the HOG feature, and then CCOT, and then they actually use the VGGNet feature to model the target object. So this is the simple CCOT framework. Again, we have a multi-scale representation. Okay, so we use this. This is the discriminative correlation filter, which we have already seen for computing the different scaled. Scaled means the blurred version of different patch. Okay, and this is the DCF framework. Okay, in CCOT, what we do? It basically prohibits join the fusion of multiple convolution layer with a different spatial resolution. So how do we solve this thing? We explicitly resample the comp to common resolution, adds a redundant data, and introduce the basically if you use the explicit resample to common resolution, it can actually add a redundant data and introduce the some artifact. If you use the independent DCF with a later fusion layer, it is not optimal because it will require huge computational power, and correlation between the layers also would be possible. CCOT is a kind of a integrating multi-resolution feature maps into learning problems. That is the very important contribution back to the CCOT community. So what they do, they take multiple resolution. They also take the different filters in a continuous domain. Okay, and then they compute the response map, and whichever scale and whichever filter at different scale give the highest possible response, we use this thing. Okay, so that is the basic idea. You can have a multi-scale as well as multi-scale filters can be used to generate the response. Okay, so this is the multi-resolution feature map. Okay, so what we do, we take a image patch, we generate the multiple resolution features with a different up to different scale by considering different channels. Okay, and then we learn this interpolation operator. Okay, this interpolation operator is nothing but it matches. So basically, when you downsample the feature map, you introduce artifacts. Okay, if you just do the simple downsampling, if you have a some interpolation operator which can actually smooth out the changes, then you will have a better response. So the smoothing operator, basically interpolation operator, converts this response map or the convolution feature map, the downsampled version, to a smoother representation. Okay, and then we do the convolution operations. Okay, so what we do, we take the smooth version of the filter, okay, and the smooth version of the response map, and then correlate the response and the filter, and we found that out of all possible scale, which scale gives the highest possible response. Okay, so that is the basic idea. So we formulate into a correlation filter framework thing, and then we come up with a weighted filter also, that SRDCF concept, and then it can learn the very good response, and it can track and locate the object very effectively. CCOT is the one such very stronger benchmark in the visual object tracking. Okay, so this is the training loss formulation. I will not go much deeper into detail, but if you use the Fourier transform representation, it can be solved using simple pseudo inverse kind of a problem. Okay, so this is the idea. So you generate the response map, okay, and then we need to basically evaluate this object tracking on a various data set. So there are data set like LOV 300++ data set, OTB data set, VOT data set. These are the data set which is available for us to evaluate. Okay, so whenever people develop a new tracker, we need to try on multiple such data sets so that we know how robust it is against the different data set. But not one data set is not comprehensive. They have a complementary video, some kind of a similar videos also there, but it is good to test on all the possible data sets so that you know you have done the benchmarking. Okay, so how they basically different data set do the evaluation? So there is called ALOV data set, which is Amsterdam Library of Ordinary Videos for tracking, consists of 314 videos. There are 14 attributes like change in the light, change in the surface cover, specularity, transparency, shape, motion, smoothness, motion coherence, clutter, confusion, low contrast, occlusion, moving camera, zooming camera, long duration. These are the different categories available for the different videos. And they use this F score, which is the harmonic mean of precision and recall. So F score basically is used to evaluate whether a tracker is doing good or not. And I hope you know what is precision and recall. And then we have a survivor curve, number of videos on x-axis whose F score is greater than the corresponding F score on the y-axis. Then we have a OTB data set. OTB again is object tracking benchmark data set, consists of OTB 50 and 100 videos. And there are 10 attributes like illumination variation, scale variation, occlusion, deformation, motion blur, fast motion, in-plane rotation, out-of-plane rotation, out-of-view, background clutters, low resolution. So there are the numbers here are the total number of videos for different category. And then you check your tracker in which all category it is working good and which all category it is not working good. And then try to develop some metric. Okay. Then they use some metrics called one-pass evaluation, temporary robustness evaluation, spatial robustness evaluation, precision plot, success plot. These are the metric they use to evaluate which is the tracker, good tracker or bad tracker. Okay. The VOT actually has 60 videos. Okay. They keep on adding different videos. So if now every year they conduct this thing, so now they have even have a IR tracking or long-term video tracking. So many new things have been added. Even complicated sequences also have been added. So each of the frame is semi-automatically annotated with any one of the following labels: the motion change, side change, camera motion, occlusion, illumination change. So this is the annual tracking benchmark activity organized by VOT initiative and platform for discussing the evaluation of advancement made in the field of visual tracking. They use this metric called accuracy and robustness. They basically rank their tracker using AR ranking. Sometimes they even change their metric for evaluation also. So this is the basic tracker. So there is something very famous tracker. It's called efficient convolutional operators in tracking. Okay. So what it does, it factored the convolutional operators into ECO that reduces the parameters in the DCF model drastically. So earlier we were learning the filters, and when we learn the filters across the multiple scale and multiple frame values, the total number of parameters to be learned are very high. Okay. So ECO basically reduces the total number of parameters required while designing a tracker. So ECO tracker proposes the method for feasible memory consumption by reducing the total number of training sample while maintaining the diversity. So it is an efficient way of selecting the how do you choose the right possible training samples for tracking the tracker. And the efficient model update the strategy as proposed in ECO, reduces the unfavorable sudden appearance changes as a result of illumination variation, out of view and deformation. So they are also capable of handling this sudden changes, illumination variation, out of play, out of view, formation, deformation, etc. So I will now show you what we actually worked on. Okay, so we with one of our students, we actually worked on this displacement consistency idea. Okay, so what is the idea? Is in order to avoid the target position deviating much from the its previous position, most of the tracker example like Siamese tracker, CFNet tracker, they employ a target centroid update strategy. that can be written as follows. So what they do, they update the centroid of the target using this simple kind of a interpolation by a linear interpolation idea. So they take the coordinates in the subsequent frames and then they use this idea to combine the targets. So basically this is called the displacement consistency, and then basically the idea is if you have x1 and x2, you use the x1 and x2 to compute the x3. But actually what happens when you do simple summation, we have a displacement error would be developed. Okay, that error has to be avoided, otherwise what it will keep on adding this error and then we would lose the track of the object. Okay? Similarly, we need to also consider the angle consistency. Angle consistency means how much is the variation in the angle in the subsequent frames. Okay, that is another idea. So what we do, we combine the, suppose the angle, if you know. So what we do, the angle consistency given by the equation 2, where w theta is the hyperparameter that performs better when w theta is equal to 0.01. So this is in our tracker, we have considered w theta to be 0.01. And what it does, it takes the two angle value and then compute the, what is the new angle value for if you have the two previous angle of the object. Okay, that is to fit the bounding box. Okay, the bounding box need not to be always rectangular, it can be rotated bounding box. Okay. Now basically this is we call as an angle consistency. Okay, this is called the angle consistency. And then I think I will rush through this thing. Okay. So what we do, we combine this angle consistency and displacement consistency, and then also we do the scale consistency, scale parameter we generate. Okay, and then we basically develop a tracker. Okay, this is the basically so this is the lot of work we have done. I think I will directly show the result. Okay, so what we do, we also take care of the illumination change variation by contrast stretching. Okay, so that also has been so scale consistency, rotation consistency, illumination consistency, all this basically idea we use, and then we propose this rotation adaptive tracker. Okay, so this is the our proposed tracker, where we give basically frame 1, we do image enhancement, we extract the feature from the base tracker, we design a filter which is based on the correlation filter tracker. Okay, and we also do what, we give this to our tracking strategy. So this is the, we also do the image enhancement. Okay, so wherever a new frame comes, we do the image enhancement, we compute the different at different scale, we also generate the rotated patches of the at different scales. Okay, so we consider 5 such rotation, and then we extract the feature, and all these feature extracted from this rotated frame are correlated from the filters which is has been learned from the this particular patch. Okay, the first patch. Okay, and then once we do correlation, whichever rotated response has the highest feature, we use that to compute the our consistency, displacement correction, and the angle correction. And this is how our tracking framework works. Okay, this is basically to bring the rotation adaptiveness. And then we did the OTB evaluation. So this is the different tracker. So if you do the tracking evaluation, this is the overlap and success rate. So this you see that how other trackers are performing with reference to the other different trackers. Okay, so this is basically our, so if you see CFNet, there are CFNet, DSR, and displacement and scale, and displacement, scale, and rotation. This is the purple color, which is the our tracking performance. So it is not as good as the ambient, but it is fairly good to other trackers as well. So that is what the, so this is how you benchmark the your tracker. And this is the precision plot. Again, we can see that precision is also good for CFNet of DSR. This is the precision plot. So I think there are some sequence I want to share with you. I will show you the sequence. I will show you another screen. So all of you can see this sequence?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Can you see this sequence, video sequence which is running?
No, sir. Not running.
Okay. I will try to do this thing. I will show you 1 second.
Yes, there is.
Now can you see?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
So now if you see here, there is a video where duck is moving. So we are comparing, our tracker with the other tracker. So this is the yellow one is the two of our tracker. So red and yellow. So we are actually also adapting to the rotation done by the concept. Dayananji, I will join. I'm in a webinar. I will join after 5 minutes. Okay, 11:30 can be rescheduled. Okay. So this is basically, you can see, how the tracking is working. Okay, so we are tracking this particular bird, and then we are adapting. So if the green tracker is the ECU tracker, which is failed on a sequence, but the proposed tracker red and RAID is basically working very effectively. Similarly, I can show you another video. I can share another video. So now can you see the sequence? So this is the sequence of a person, doing skiing and dance. So we are trying to compare again SRDCF and our proposed tracker. Okay, and then also ground truth is also there. So we are trying to generate the bounding box which can enclose this girl into a particular frame. Okay, so we should keep on tracking this particular girl in the subsequent video frames. So this is how basically we generate this. This is just for visualization. Actually, for evaluation purpose, we do using our tracking algorithm. You have a fair idea about what basically we do. So now I will share my slides again, and I will try to finish the time. Okay. So now we will come to the I am skipping some of the slides because time is short. There is another problem is called multi-object tracking, where you want to track multiple objects and then detect the IDs of each person, and then it is basically useful in crowd tracking, multiple vehicles tracking, lot of biological samples if you want to track. So this is also very important area. So MOT basically deals with the detecting the object, predicting the location in the current frame set of object, match the prediction to the actual measurement, update the object trajectory, update the image stabilized reference coordinate system. So that are the following steps are required. And then you have to keep on tracking the object. So there are possible region where tracking would occlude with each other, and then you will miss the trajectories. Okay, that is another problem that basically you have. So how do you really take care of that thing? So there is something called multi-object tracking by decision making. So they use this MDP Markov decision process framework to track the object. So they define, you know, some states, then track state, lost state, and track state. So whenever object is continuously tracking, that is basically called as a tracking state. So this is the idea. So once object is detection happen, that is called the active state. And then we have a tracked state, lost state, and inactive state. So basically, once the object is seen, if it is seen in every possible frame, it will remain in the tracked state and then will keep on looping there. Suppose in some frame it is not available, it will go into the lost state. And if it is remain lost for multiple frame, we send this to an inactive state. Okay, but it might happen that it might reappear after some time. So then it will go back to a tracked state. So this is the simple, very simple framework which can use to track the multiple objects. Okay, so we define four state: active state, tracked state, lost state, and inactive state. And every time a new object comes to active state, we define a trajectory for that thing. Okay? Again, there are a lot of multi-object tracking benchmarks are there. This is called MOT benchmark, and you can actually, if you're interested, you can go there and then. So MOT is another very important area, but I'm not discussing too detail into this thing because it is difficult to cover in 1 hour. Okay, and these are some metric they use: multi-object tracking accuracy, multi-object tracking precision, mostly tracked targets, mostly lost target, total number of false positive, false negative, identity switch, fragmented. Okay, and then frequency, how many frame per second you can process. The green ones has to be higher and the orange one has to be lower. Okay, that is the basic idea of a tracker. So these are the some, you know, results you will compute, and then you can actually try different sequences. There's different sequences, you know, track multiple objects. Mostly it is done for a human tracking, okay, for multi-object tracking. And so these are the some, you know, references which you can refer for knowing more about the tracking. Although I rushed through a couple of topics, let's say this multi-object tracking and the whatever work we have done, but I think the basic idea of tracking should be clear to you. And if you need more information, you can always write to me. I will be able to help you with that. Okay? So these are just a couple of references that you can use for knowing more. Okay? So thank you very much. Yes, sir. So I'm done with my presentation. If they have.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much for the wonderful presentation, sir.
Yeah, I took a little more time, but I think.
It's okay. No issues, sir. We have some questions, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. What are the real time applications of visual object tracking? What it is utilized mostly nowadays?
Huh?
What are the real time applications of visual object tracking? Where it is utilized mostly nowadays?
It is used in surveillance. Okay, surveillance setup. All the surveillance people use. It is used in the biomedical thing. It is used in augmented reality application where you are basically tracking the hand of a person. Okay, it is also useful in thermal images. So now, if you want to track the person crossing the border in the night, you can actually use the thermal images to track the motion of the person. So for any chasing problem, it is basically, it can be used.
Thank you, sir. The one more question is, which software used for tracking systems?
You can use the MATLAB. OpenCV has a inbuilt tracker. If you go to OpenCV, they have an inbuilt tracker. Even MATLAB has a their own this thing. Madam, I will call you later. So they also have their own tracker, this computer vision library, OpenCV library. Even MATLAB has, you can write your program in MATLAB, and there are a lot of open source trackers are available in Python. Okay, some people do use Python also. But if you only want to use software, then OpenCV has the tracker, inbuilt tracker is there. So you can directly use that.
Thank you, sir. So one more question is applications in biomedical engineering.
So if you want to track, let's say, cells, okay, you have RBC and RedBC. Okay, so when you take a blood sample, you want to develop a pathological solution. You want to count how many RBC cells are there, how many WBCs are there. So, and then you want to use, let's say, a flowing mechanism without doing this thing. So you take blood samples and it is flowing through a very capillary kind of a tube, and then you do a imaging through a camera, and then while flowing you can actually count which all trackers are there and how they are projecting, how they are interacting. So that is the use of a biomedical thing, and people also use for image guided surgery. So suppose you want to track where is the, you know, needle is going, you can even track that as well.
Okay, thank you, sir. So one more, the difference between visual object tracking and image processing, which one is having more application area?
Image processing.
Yes sir.
Image processing is basically, you know, you deal with the single images, you enhance the images. Visual object tracking is the part of computer vision, okay, where we basically track the object, or we process, we want to infer, extract information from the video. That is basically visual object. So they are, image processing is the tool which we use in the enhancing the images. Okay, so there are image processing is a kind of a subset of computer vision, you can say that. Okay. And computer vision has so many applications, like tracking is one such aspect, okay, but there are many other applications in computer vision.
Thank you sir. How much distance it will track?
Again, there are not, long term trackers are not successful, so there are some, you know, only short term trackers are there, but I think they can track up to, let's say, you know, some trackers can track, if the object is not changing much, you can track as long as possible, but in real time I think you can track up to, let's say, you know, 3 minutes or something. Okay, not beyond 3 minutes. That is what I have seen.
Thank you, sir. Hope we have answered for all questions. Dear participants, any other questions? Kindly post in your chat box. So I think thank you very much for your wonderful presentation and accepting invitation with us, sir.
It's a pleasure.
Thank you very much.
If they can always write, you can share my email ID with them. I will also share the slides with you so that you can share with the participant if you want.
Sure.
Yeah, they can always write to me, and if they have some doubt, we can help them in tracking that.
Sure. So one more question. Yeah. How this plays a role in AI?
How much?
How the visual object tracking plays a role in AI, artificial intelligence?
Autonomous driving. Suppose autonomous driving you want to do, okay, and then you want to track, you know, the motion of the object, whether how the other car is moving. Okay, so if you want to track, you know, basically in a airport, you want to track the lost object. Okay, so those kind of a problem, actually, you can actually use this tracking. Okay, if you want to track the person in a airport, suppose suspect is there. So AI is a very bigger area. Okay, and object tracking is a very small part in the AI. Okay? So whenever you have an application where you want to track something continuously, or you want to locate something continuously, you want to count, you want to understand the behavior of a people, so there actually this tracking would be useful.
Okay, thank you sir. Thank you very much for your wonderful presentation, sir.
Yes,
we will meet again on another occasion.
Yes.
Thank you.
So can I disconnect?
Yes sir, you can disconnect, sir.
Okay, fine. Thank you sir.
Yeah, hope all are enjoyed, and you have learned something about visual object tracking. Okay, next session will start at 2:00. So before that, we will share a link through mail and also WhatsApp group. So kindly join before 5 minutes. Okay, 80% of attendance is needed for certificate. So kindly please attend all sessions and get benefited. And thank you very much. We will meet again at 2 o'clock. Thank you.